It's been 3 days. I can still see the pain, the strain, the blood that drained that day at Calvary. They pierced his hands, his feet, for all to see this man, this king, this Jesus. This tangible passion, this relentless abandon, this love, this hope was gone. But Jesus wasn't finished yet. Today, the stone's been rolled away. The grave has lost its claim of victory. Death has given way to life, to grace. Our sin replaced, erased by mercy. Hope is alive. Mercy can thrive, revive, bring to life the hearts of man. Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He is risen.
Well, good morning, everybody. So good to see you this morning. Welcome. It is Easter Sunday. He is risen. The event that changed the course of history. We celebrate it today, that the Lord Jesus Christ on the third day, he rose from the dead victorious over death, hell, and the grave so that we could have life and we could have life more abundantly. Let's celebrate this morning.
You have
this morning. This is our story.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you.
Yeah.
I was breathing, but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I.
God, we thank you for the victory of the resurrection, Lord. In one moment when the devil and the powers of hell thought they'd won a victory, you rose from the dead. And that event, Lord, changed the world. It changed the course of history, and it changed the life of everyone that comes to you and says, I want that life that you offer. We worship you this morning. Give you high praise.
Thank you.
worship you. I worship you. You are here working in this room. I worship you. I worship you. You are here moving in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here working in this room. I worship you. I worship you.
Sing together.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship.
Sing us a prayer of faith today.
Even when I can't see it, you're working. Even when I can't feel it, you're moving. You never stop working, never stop moving. Even when I can't see it, you're working. Even when I can't feel it, you're moving. You never stop working.
Come on.
Even when I can't see it, you're working. Even when I can't feel it, you're moving. You never stop working. Even when I can't see it, you're working. Even when I can't feel it, you're moving. You never stop working. You never stop moving. Waymaker.
Pray this over every relationship. Sing it.
Waymaker, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. That is who you are.
Oh, Jesus, yours is the victory.
God, we thank you for the victory of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, our living hope. There is salvation in the name of Jesus and in the name of Jesus alone. You conquered hell and death and the grave, and you overcome our sin. For all of those that would trust you, you are our living hope. You are our peace. You are our joy. You are our comfort. And you are the assurance of the kingdom come in this life and the next. We worship you and declare that you are risen from the dead. We bless your name. In Jesus' name, amen.
In the beginning,
God created
the heavens
and the earth.
God said,
it was all good.
Adam and Eve
were the first people on earth.
They can eat any fruit from any tree,
but not the fruit of this one tree.
They thought they were smarter than God.
So they ate the fruit.
They sinned against God.
At that moment,
all creation was broken.
Now there was sin.
Death! Suffering.
Oh no!
People are now separated from God.
We need a savior.
Who can save us?
God loved us so much.
He gave us Jesus,
his only son,
to come to this earth.
He taught us.
He healed us.
Loved us.
He wanted us all to go to heaven.
To be with us forever.
It all began
when he went into Jerusalem.
He rode in on a donkey.
People waved palm branches and yelled Hosanna.
Hosanna.
Later.
Jesus was betrayed.
He was arrested.
But he was innocent.
He was beaten
and mocked.
He suffered.
He was
crucified
on the cross
and was buried
for you,
for me,
for all of us.
We don't have to pay
the price of sin.
Are set free
and given a new life.
But that's not the end of the story.
There's more.
3 days later,
on Easter,
Jesus rose from the grave.
Wow! That's right.
Our God's not dead.
He is alive.
He's alive!
Why do we celebrate Easter?
Why do we celebrate Easter?
Jesus
died for us.
It rose for us.
So that one day,
we can be in heaven.
Having a party with Jesus.
That's why we celebrate Easter.
Hello, everyone, and happy Easter. We're so honored you have chosen to spend your Easter morning with us. We imagined you're in your living room, sitting around your kitchen table, or holding a warm cup of coffee. Well, we welcome you from our home to yours. Thanks for gathering with the East Hill Church family today. In just a few minutes, we're going to dive into worship and then hear a special message from our Pastor Keith, who we lovingly call PK. But before that, I wanted to give you a special Easter announcement. Whether you're new with us or you've been part of the family for a while, connecting with you is so important to us. Please take a moment today to go to easthill.org/connect and connect with us. If you're watching through easthill.live, you can simply click the Connect With Us button above. Okay, so here's the special announcement. If you fill out a Connect card today, Easter Sunday, we will enter you into a raffle for a digital Applebee's gift card. We are picking 5 winners from each service to receive this special Easter gift from us. So go, right now, go fill out that Connect card. Thank you, East Hill, for continuing to be generous with your giving. This enables us to continue our mission, bringing people all over the world into a loving and growing relationship with Jesus. When we give, it is another way to express our worship and devotion to God. We have several convenient ways to give your tithes and offerings. Please go to easthill.org/give to see all the options for giving, or simply click the Give button above. Every Sunday at 9 and 11 a.m., you can find us here at easthill.live or on Facebook Live. This is how we gather each week to find encouragement in God's Word, fellowship with each other, and hope in the midst of every circumstance. We're going to have a great morning, East Hill family. Happy Easter.
Hey, thanks for helping me out with all this. Man, my kids sure do love Easter.
Ah, who doesn't love Easter? Am I right?
Yeah, that's right. But if you really think about it, leading up to that very first Easter, Jesus had it pretty rough.
Well, I never really thought of that. I wonder what happened to that guy.
Well, you know, he died on the cross.
Really?
Yeah.
No, that's a different guy. I'm thinking of the Jesus that, what's his last name?
No. That's the same guy.
Wow. I guess I never really connected the two together before. Jesus on a cross. I wonder whatever happened to that guy.
You know he, came back to life 3 days later.
What?
Yeah.
Wait. We're still talking about tomb Jesus.
Yeah.
That's the same guy?
Yeah. He died on the cross for our sins.
No, that's a different Jesus.
No. Same one. Jesus died on a cross, was buried in a tomb, came back to life, and then now he sits at the right hand of God.
Wait. So right hand of God Jesus is the same as cross Jesus?
Yeah.
Not separate Jesuses.
There are no separate Jesuses.
Wow. I guess I just never really put them all together before.
No, it's still one guy.
Wait. You understand what that means, don't you? One guy did all of that. I mean, that changes history. That changes everything. That is big. He deserves more than just jelly beans for his birthday. So does that mean that the Easter Bunny is the...
No.
Good morning, East Hill, and a special good morning to those of you who have become a part of our online family. Thank you for tuning in and being a part of our worship experience. Well, you know what it is. You know what today is. It's Easter Sunday morning, Resurrection Sunday. Come on, somebody. On the count of three, wherever you are and wherever you're watching from, we want to have a collective shout of praise. On three, I want you to shout, "He is risen," okay? On three. So get up. Get the kids up, get grandma and grandpa up, get the animals off the couch. Just so you know, animals don't belong on the couch. If you're ready, on the count of three, ready? One, two, three. He is risen! Come on, that was awesome. Nothing that can ever confront us can undo what he alone has done once and for all. The scriptures say in Luke chapter 24, verse 1-8, on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they entered, they didn't find the body of the Lord Jesus. And verse 4 says, while they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He is risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee, the Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again." Then they remembered his words. Thank God that death in the grave could not hold him. He is indeed risen. As much as I can, I try to make my sermons a team effort, a collaborative effort, as it were. Therefore, I can't take credit for the series we're about to enter into. It was during a blue sky session while our team was sifting through ideas and concepts that the phrase, "This changes everything," began to bubble to the surface. I immediately latched onto it as a central thought for our Easter series. It felt like the Lord wanted us to spend a few weeks pondering the implications and, more importantly, the applications of the resurrection of Jesus. Now, it seems really appropriate now because literally everything in our world has changed. None of us could have imagined the reality of what we are all living through right now. Let's all lean in together and draw some much needed encouragement and hope from the scriptures. Open your Bibles, if you will, to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. I'll give you a second to get there. And let's take a few minutes to listen to what the Apostle Paul said about the resurrection. And we are about to pick it up, that narrative, we're going to pick it up in verse 14. So skip down chapter 15 all the way down to verse 14. And it says this, Paul writes, "And if Christ has not been raised, then all our preaching is useless and your faith is useless." In verse 17, it says, "And if Christ has not been raised, then your faith is absolutely useless and you are still guilty of your sins." Verse 18, "And in that case, all who have died believing in Christ are lost. And if our hope in Christ is only for this life, we are more to be pitied than anyone in the world." But here's the good news in verse 20. "But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, and he is the first of a great harvest of all who have died. We know that the resurrection of Jesus changed everything, is changing everything, and will continue to change everything." Amen? This morning, given the global crisis that the COVID-19 virus has created, if we are honest, we find ourselves confused, uncertain about the future, looking daily for relief and answers, all the while battling personal fear and anxiety, trying our best to reassure our children that everything's going to be all right eventually, wondering even how we will continue to protect or provide for ourselves, wrestling with discouragement, despair, and disillusionment as well. That we're not enough to deal with, we're all cut off and isolated from one another. I was thinking this week, as I was preparing this message, that we have never had more in common with the first century disciples following Jesus' death than we do right now. You have to pause for a moment and reflect on their journey and story to capture the significance of the resurrection from their vantage point. They had followed Jesus for several years and began to hope and believe that he was the long-awaited Messiah of Israel, the one they were collectively waiting for, who would throw off the yoke of their oppressors and return Israel back to her former glory. I mean, sure, no one had heard anyone speak like Jesus did, and definitely nobody had demonstrated such power. Significant miracles were accompanying his ministry. No one had ever seen anything like this before. The crowds began to swell, and his popularity grew. So much so, the religious leaders of his day were jealous of him and began to conspire as to how they could put him to death without obviously being accused by the crowds of people who were following him. You can imagine everyone wondering, could this really be the one? But Jesus was always quite confusing, as he is still now. There's a bit of mystery that surrounds Jesus. Even as followers of him today, we still struggle sometimes to understand what he's doing in a given moment. I mean, he didn't always do things, the right things, or the things that you would think someone would do to gather a following. For instance, the disciples he chose were a ragtag bunch, and they even had a tax collector among them. He hung out with the wrong crowd. If you were a Pharisee or a rabbi, a teacher, he would have been with the wrong crowd. Prostitutes, tax collectors, those on the margins. Not those that were upperly mobile or those with power or resources. This is sort of the blueprint you use to not create a movement. Surely the Messiah would also need an army, right? And when he arrived, he would do so riding on at the head of his army on a white horse, sort of like Maximus in The Gladiator. He would be unmistakable. But again, Jesus rides in a week before in his triumphal entry into Jerusalem on a donkey. No army, no rose petals were thrown before him, but instead, palm branches were thrown in his pathway, an ancient symbol of victory, triumph, and peace. But wait, what victory? What triumph? It doesn't look like anything changed. In fact, on the surface, nothing did. The nation of Israel was awaiting the coming of their Messiah and could not have imagined in a million years that he would die at the hands of pagans. Even his closest followers never did quite get it or get him while he was with them. Towards the end of his earthly life, he began to talk about death and leaving. And in John chapter 14, he talked about sending a comforter or a helper. And could you imagine them asking themselves, isn't he the Messiah? And wait a minute, aren't we going to overthrow the Roman Empire? I like that we, like they're going to do something. Isn't he the king that will sit on David's throne eternally? so many questions unanswered. See, on the surface, or at first glance, nothing had changed. But let's look closer. In fact, we should always look closer, looking deeper, especially when we're dealing with one another. There's always more than what meets the eye. Jesus was indeed the King of Kings. His kingdom is invisible and eternal. He sets up his throne in the hearts of his followers. An epic revolution was occurring without a shot ever being fired. And initially, only one casualty, Jesus, died. Which, to even utter those words now, seems ridiculous. But let's go back to Good Friday for a moment. Let's go back out to the place of skull, to Golgotha or Calvary, where Jesus died. And the hopes that the disciples had for a different future died as well. They were rightfully discouraged and disillusioned. Who had ever heard of someone returning back from the grave? No one. There was no tradition in the ancient world that would have allowed for such a thing to even be thought. Death was a one-way street. You died never to return. Of course, there were countless after-death theories that abounded. And even within Judaism, there were divisions about the resurrection. One faction called the Sadducees denied the resurrection of the dead altogether. And another, the Pharisees, held to a future resurrection of the dead. But it wasn't quite clear whether they believed in a bodily resurrection. There was no precedence in the known world of a person coming back from the grave after death, which makes the resurrection of Lazarus after 3 days and Jesus' declaration so startling in John chapter 11, verse 25 through 26, where he says, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die." Can you imagine, even with that miracle fresh in their minds, Jesus' dying was still an unthinkable event. The most shameful kind of death, crucifixion. The disciples were devastated. All hopes of a different future vanished that day as they watched him die. Peter, despondent, decided to return to something he could count on, something familiar in the midst of such confusion and uncertainty. He decides in John chapter 21, Simon Peter says, "I'm going fishing." And what did all of the disciples say? "We'll come too." So they went out in the boat, the Bible says, but they caught nothing at night. Jesus' closest friends, think about it, did not expect to see him again. They were not huddled together with expectancy. But things were about to change. Mark chapter 16 and verse 2 says this: "Very early on Sunday morning, just at sunrise, they went to the tomb. On the way, they were asking each other, 'Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb?' But as they arrived, they looked up and saw that the stone was very large, had already been rolled aside. When they entered the tomb, they saw a young man clothed in a white robe sitting on the right side. The women were shocked, but the angel said, 'Don't be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified.' So we know who he is. 'He isn't here. He is risen from the dead. Look, this is where they laid his body. Lastly, now go and tell his disciples, including Peter, the one that had denied him, you remember, that Jesus is going ahead of you to Galilee. You will see him there just as he told you before he died.'" Again, at a glance, it doesn't appear that anything revolutionary is happening. His missing body can easily be explained by the religious leaders of his day. They simply accused his followers of stealing his body. Not to mention, disclaimer, ladies, in that culture, women were not esteemed highly, quite the opposite. And they would have quickly been discredited, and their claims would not have been given any validity at all. But look closer. Everything about Jesus has meaning. Ladies, he is making a statement about your place in his kingdom. They were honored to receive such good news and to be among the first messengers of his resurrection, not Peter or any other notable disciples. In our courts, there is significant power in the testimony of a firsthand witness. Someone who has had firsthand knowledge about events is very credible. Why did those who were timid and fearful, discouraged and despondent suddenly become courageous and emboldened. They surely had nothing to gain, no fame. They wouldn't suddenly become rich by carrying this message, and they had no reason to lie about his resurrection. Usually when a person lies, there are predictable motives associated with it: money, sex, notoriety, or power. But the disciples got none of these. They lost property. They never amassed any wealth. They were persecuted and died horrific deaths. But watch this. None of them ever stopped preaching the message of Jesus' resurrection. It was the message that the first century church was founded upon. The resurrection changed everything for several reasons, in my opinion. First, Jesus is who he claimed to be. John chapter 11 and 25 says this, again, I'm the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies. His resurrection validated everything he was trying to convey about himself to his disciples and to now us for thousands of years. Everything was suddenly clear for them as they saw and listened to him. Jesus stepped right into the midst of their confusion and fear in John chapter 20, verse 19. And it says this, then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, Jesus came, listen to this, Jesus came and stood in the midst and said to them, peace be with you. In your home right now, while you're watching this, that same Jesus is saying to all of us in the middle of this crisis, peace be with you. He is our peace, in fact, now and forever. Amen. Secondly, Jesus has the power he claimed to have. In Matthew 28 and 18, it says, all power in heaven and on earth is given to me. Jesus has the power over death and the grave. The last enemy for all of us to conquer has already been conquered by Jesus. He is the first among many, though, to be resurrected. 1 Corinthians 15 and 20 says this, but in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead. He is the first of a great harvest of all who have died. Verse 21, so you see, just as death came into the world through one man, now the resurrection from the dead has begun through another man, Jesus. No one could ever take his authority or his power. No one could ever dominate over Jesus. John chapter 10 and 18 says it this way, no one takes my life from me. I have the power to lay it down and I have the power to take it up again. You may feel weak today and without strength. Jesus has the power he claimed to have. Indeed, all power. Bring your weakened relational resolve to him, maybe. Before you contemplate separation or divorce, bring that illness. Whatever you face that is beyond human help and strength, his power is available and is effectual. Lastly, Jesus does what he promises to do. This is especially significant for those of us who have had promises broken, and the word of many we tried to lean on seemed to be worthless. Jesus foretold of his death and that he would be resurrected. Furthermore, the Old Testament pointed to the same. From his birth, his life, his suffering, and ultimate victory over death, he foretold of it and he kept his word. Mark chapter 10 and 34 says, they will mock and flog and kill me, but after 3 days, come on y'all, after 3 days, I will come back to life. Matthew 28 and 5 through 6 says, the angel said, don't be frightened. I know you are looking for Jesus who was crucified, but he isn't here. He has come back to life again, just as he said he would. The truth of this message can change everything in your life today and give you a new start. But there's a couple things you got to do. You got to apply. You got to respond to this message. And here's the first thing you got to do. You got to open your mind up to the power of God. Look at what the scripture says. In Romans 12 and verse 2, it says, let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. And in Ephesians 4 and 18, it says, many are far away from the life of God because they have shut their minds against him so they can't understand his ways. Just receive him. As you are, just receive him. Don't let a million unanswered questions rob you of the truth of the most important question already answered, which is this: who will be your savior? Who is able to deliver? It is Jesus, the one who had the power over death and the grave. Yield to him. Secondly, open your heart up to God's grace. Ephesians 1 and 8 says this, God has showered upon us the richness of his grace, for he understands us. Stop for a minute. He understands us. And then it says, and he knows what's best for us. That's amazing to know that I have a God that understands how I'm made, where I'm weak, where I'm strong, and he knows what's best for me. Romans 3 and 22 says it this way. God says he will accept and acquit us, declare us not guilty if we trust Jesus Christ to take away our sins. And we all can be saved in the same way by coming to Christ, no matter who we are or what we have been like. It's by God's grace. Listen, we cannot earn God's forgiveness. He has made reconciliation with him possible only through the death and the resurrection of his son, Jesus. We have nothing in our world to compare to grace. We literally try to earn everything we get. But this gift requires that you simply accept it. It's God's free gift of salvation. Just as he says in Ephesians 2 and 8, saving is all his idea. It's all God's idea and all his work. All we do is trust him enough to let him do it. It's God's gift, again, I say, from start to finish. Amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I was lost, but now I'm found. 'Twas blind, but now I see. Listen, we can take no credit for it. It is by the goodness of God and his great love for each and every one of us. Listen, whatever you've done that has left you feeling ashamed and unforgivable, grace runs after people like us to retrieve us, reconciling us to God and restoring our lives. Lastly, open your life to God's love. Ephesians 3 and 16 says this, I pray that Christ will live in you as you open the door and invite him in, and that you will be able to feel and understand how long, how wide, how deep, and how high his love really is, and to experience his love for yourself. I want you to recognize that God's love is inexhaustible. He loves you beyond anything you can fathom. You may find yourself alone this morning and without love in your life. Maybe you feel unlovable because of the way you have previously lived. Why don't you take a risk this morning? You've risked before and no doubt lost. You risked money as you've gambled. Some of you went to Vegas or wherever you've gone, bingo. You've risked and lost. You've risked relationally, and we've all lost in love. But this time, you're going to win because God's love is certain, especially toward those who feel as though they are least deserving of it. Paul writes in Romans 5, verse 1 and 2, he says, we throw open our doors to God and discover at the same moment that he has already thrown open his doors to us. My friend, God has been arranging the circumstances of your life to bring you to this moment. You didn't think that God would want to be in a relationship with you. But the truth is, through Jesus Christ, he was creating a pathway home for you that didn't exist without his sacrificial death. Right now, there's a battle raging over your soul. That distractions and distortions and all types of things have been trying to come against the knowledge of God in your life so that you would never receive the gospel. I want you to know that that battle is going to be lost today over your soul, because God never loses and he won't lose today. Would you just take a minute while you prayerfully contemplate all that I've said this morning? Listen to this song, and then I'm going to come back and pray with you.
When you move, such an easy thing for you to do. Your hand is moving right now. You are still showing up at the tomb of every Lazarus, and your voice is calling me out. You can do all. you never lost a battle. No, you never lost a battle. And I know, you never will. Everything's possible by the power of the Holy Ghost. A new wind is blowing.
Wow, that was an amazing song. That song has literally become like an anthem in my life. There's so many battles and different things that come, whether relationally, whether financially, whether in health. There's so many battles. Isn't it good to know that we serve a God that has never lost a battle? Whether it be over death in the grave, which we celebrate today on Resurrection Sunday, or any battle in your life. But the most important battle was won on that day when he came out of the grave. It was to assure that you and I could be reconciled with God. So this morning, all of this has been about this moment where we get an opportunity to give our hearts over to the Lord, to surrender to him, to acknowledge that Jesus is indeed the Savior that we need. We live in a time where every God of this world has failed miserably, and yet our God has never lost a battle. COVID-19 will not defeat our God, and whatever's arrayed itself against your life will not defeat you either. The first victory comes, though. It's going to sound weird. The first victory comes through surrender, when we surrender our lives to Jesus. Now, if you're ready, I want to lead you in a prayer. And all you have to do is repeat after me. And if you will, just bow your head in your heart right where you are and just repeat after me. Lord Jesus, for too long, I've kept you out of my life. I know that I'm a sinner and that I cannot save myself. No longer will I close the door when I hear you knocking like you are this morning. But by faith, I gratefully receive your salvation, the gift of salvation. I'm ready to trust you as my Lord and Savior. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for coming to the earth. I believe you are the Son of God and that you died on the cross for my sins and rose from the dead on the third day. Thank you for bearing my sin and giving me the gift of eternal life. I believe your words are true, and I now surrender my heart to you. Lord Jesus, be my Savior. Amen and amen. Hey, welcome to the family. You've been born again, and you've been forgiven by God through Jesus Christ. Everything you have ever done has been forgiven and washed away. Praise the Lord. That's awesome. You are now in position to start rebuilding your life, this new life in Christ, as he leads you and as his Spirit empowers you. I know you have a ton of questions and a lot to learn, but be at peace. The Lord will guide you every step of the way. You just keep yielding to him like you did in this moment, and he will take care of all the other details. Hey, listen, thanks everyone for joining us this morning. I know many of you this afternoon, the hams are ready, the pies are ready, and all of the fams, however you can gather together. Some of you are going to Zoom relatives in. I got you. Have a great time this afternoon celebrating the resurrection of Jesus. Be mindful, though, of those around us that are single and elderly and are alone. Do your best to express love to them and include them as best you can. Remember, God is in control. And he will keep all of us in his love, both now and forever. Listen, East Hill, keep investing in relationships and keep inviting people to join us online. Listen, everybody, have a great, grace-filled week. I love you.